My name's Dylan. If you're new around here, I just put a PhD in physics on hold, create some fun things. So come check this out. Oh, it's a nice result. Oh, shit. So if you want to turn your car into a street car, how about a time machine? I promised you guys a time machine. It's as good as it's going to get, unfortunately, because I dropped out of that PhD. So yeah, I mean, I want to see these results. I haven't seen these. Sick. Let me show you AI My Interior, which actually gives like photorealistic results. So I made these. These are my babies. If you ever click on these, right, you know how you've got the private option? You don't have to put your room or your car online, right? And pretty much everyone is choosing this private option. So if it looks like you come here and it's the same pictures, it's because everyone's just choosing the private one. We get a lot of uses each day. It's going very well. And one more thing, I created Kel, which is the world's first post-quantum VPN. It's got post-quantum cryptography in it, right? And this stuff is going to be very important going forward. A lot of countries at the moment, they're all really racing to try and upgrade their standards of encryption. And I was like, I'm going to not do the business-to-business approach. I want to try and do the consumer, help people approach. So that's enough of that.
The universe looks like a vast empty ocean sprinkled with rare islands of galaxies. But this is an illusion. Just a small fraction of all atoms are found in galaxies, while the rest is thought to be drifting in between, in the intergalactic medium. Like the roots of some massive tree, gas...
It's a bit of misinformation there. It's a very small amount. You know, so he's just painted a picture for people that is really not quite it is. It really is like islands in a vast ocean. And we've recently... What he's talking about, yeah, we've recently discovered these filaments, these magnetic islands, if you will, that connect the galaxies in some weird ways. And not they don't completely connect them. But it looks like there are these weird connections we're not really understanding. And more than that, you know, you have supernova explosions sort of like sometimes on the edges of galaxies, and they also shoot out these giant magnetic fields. But beyond that, you know, if you know much about dark matter, we kind of think of, you might have heard something called the cosmic web. This is just dark matter, okay? And it's like this, it looks like neurons and the connections in a brain. This is actually from the Millennium simulations, which I was toying around with a lot in my honors thesis and my PhD. Used to play with the Millennium simulations a lot, really cool. N-body dark matter simulation. So you're just simulating dark matter and gravity. And it's also, you could also call them cosmological simulations, right? And then this is, does not include any baryonic matter, like galaxies and just all the stuff you can think of, basically. This is just dark matter. See how this is like a web? This structure you're seeing is just dark matter. And then there's like these filaments. And where you find the galaxy is actually at these sort of like nodes. And these bright bits are what you would call BCGs, brightest cluster galaxies. They're the big boys. And the centers of these big boys... the even bigger, I don't want to sound racist, bigger dark boys, the big black holes, the supermassive boys. So I just wanted to give you this little bit of context because I was like, oh, that's nice.
Spreads out from each galaxy, gravity funneling fresh mass.
But this is really new stuff. I kind of want to talk about this a little bit more though, like because he did sort of say something that is like, you know, there's not that much matter between the galaxies.
Into this dense cosmic forest.
Matter slash energy, you should say.
Here in the intergalactic medium are the raw materials of creation. Hydrogen and helium.
Maybe. This is all still theoretical stuff. You know, like there's still lots of verification required. Verification is, you know, observations in astrophysics.
Woven into sheets and filaments that flow into galaxies where they eventually create stars. But if we look closely, we see who's actually in charge.
Like, because we do, the way we do theories and stuff in astrophysics is you do computer simulations and you put all the physics you currently know about in a computer simulation. So you call them like theoretical slash computational astrophysicists, and that's what I was doing. And then you have the observers, the observational astrophysicists, and they deal with all the telescopes and, you know, like JWST. The theorists, they kind of like put stuff in their simulations. They try to, you know, and then they, you know, run their simulation to see what happens. They try to make it look like the real universe. That's kind of like, you know, what you use to fine tune it, and you know, you make kind of changes to parameters, maybe you include some new physics, and then if it looks maybe closer to what the real universe looks like, or if you see something new, well then you write a paper about it, that's you, and you make a prediction, and you give that to the observers, and you say, look, this is what we should see, if my sort of hypothesis is correct about this new, you know, parameter or whatever. And sometimes that works out, and that's how we are discovering new things in astrophysics all the time. It's really cool.
The single most powerful objects in existence. As small as a grain of sand compared to the Amazon River, they reside in the centers of some galaxies, shining with the power of a trillion stars, blasting out huge jets of matter, completely reshaping the cosmos around them.
This is such a sick animation.
So powerful that they can kill a galaxy. What are they, and how do they mold the structure of the universe at their whim?
Am I nuts?
Everywhere you look, weird things in the sky. In the 1950s,
this guy's been watching my videos.
Astronomers noticed mysterious loud radio waves coming from spots all over the sky.
Weird shit.
They
everywhere.
Were named quasi-stellar radio sources, or quasars, because they were dots like stars, but were seen in radio waves rather than visible light. Everything about them was strange. Some flickered, others emitted high-energy X-rays in addition to radio waves, but all seemed to be tiny. They all moved extremely fast, as much as over 30% the speed of light. The only explanation was that they must have been so distant that their apparent speed was actually the expansion of the universe moving them away from us. But these enormous distances meant that quasars couldn't just be stars, but the active cores of galaxies billions of light years away. And it gets crazier. To appear so bright and loud, given these vast distances, they
best soundtrack in a Kozak video I've heard today.
They are thousands of times brighter than the entire Milky Way. Monsters exploding and screaming into the void with a violence not thought possible before.
That's not a very good like representation of what's happening, but hopefully they talk about it.
As we mapped the sky, we discovered over a million quasars, and they all seem to be very far away. Looking into space far away means very long ago, because light takes so long to reach us.
Yes.
Quasars were common in the early universe, having peaked in number 10 billion years ago when galaxies and the universe itself were still very young. Let's go back in time, just 3 billion years after the Big Bang, and see what was going on back then. The incredible power of quasars.
Nice.
How could an early baby galaxy be so incredibly bright and violent?
This is one of the things I was looking at for my PhD, early galaxy formation, and how, you know, there were these massive galaxies so early in the universe. You know, so how did baby galaxies get so big so quickly? We have no idea still. We really don't. And so take, for instance, what you'd call the progenitor of the Milky Way. Right, because since the very early universe, you know, galaxies have merged, right? And so if you walk back, you know, the history of galaxies, there's actually multiple sort of all in one now, right? And you call this like a progenitor walk, and you write a little algorithm for your simulation and you go backwards. And so the Milky Way, its progenitor, at this point in time, let's go to about a billion years after the Big Bang, it would have been like 50 times smaller physically, but it would almost have, you know, a similar sort of mass already, which is really crazy. So these things grew really quickly, and then they kind of just leveled off at a, you know, relatively early point in the universe. And all of this stuff is still quite mysterious.
All that light and radiation couldn't be stars, as there weren't nearly enough of them. And since galaxies tend to grow with time by merging, the starlight from small galaxies shouldn't be far brighter than any galaxy today. There's only one way to generate the vast amounts of energy a quasar shines with: feeding supermassive black holes. We still don't know how exactly they formed, but it seems that every galaxy has one in their center. But how can the brightest things in the universe be black holes, which trap anything and everything that crosses their event horizon? Well, the light of a quasar is not coming from inside these black holes. Rather, it comes from the space around them, a massive orbiting disk of gas called an accretion disk. Quasars use the same fuel as stars to shine: matter. It's just that black holes are the most efficient engines for converting matter into energy in the universe. The energy released by matter falling into a black hole can be 60 times greater than that released by nuclear fusion in the core of a star, because the energy released by a black hole comes from gravity, not from nuclear reactions. Matter falling into a black hole speeds up to almost the speed of light before it crosses the event horizon, buzzing with an incredible amount of kinetic energy. Of course, once inside the black hole, it takes that energy with it. You only get to witness this energy if you drop your matter in the right way. Fall straight down, and the outside universe gets nothing. But when you have a lot of matter, it spirals in incredibly fast towards the event horizon.
So that's not necessarily true. Like, he's kind of just... I keep saying he. I know it's a big team of people. They're forgetting that Hawking radiation is a thing. So, like, saying the universe gets nothing isn't quite true. And actually, when, you know, you get near black holes, depending on its size, you could be met with a firewall of radiation. You know, there's lots of hypotheses about this. When talking about this stuff and visualizing it, you got to be like hyper careful.
Forming a disk. Collisions between particles and friction heated up to hundreds of thousands of degrees. In a space not much bigger than our solar system, the core of a galaxy can release many times more energy than all its stars combined. This.
Yeah, it also results in like a flat disk, accretion disk around it, due to the conservation of angular momentum, just like why spiral galaxies and things are like flat disks as well.
The quasar is a supermassive black hole having a feast. And these black holes eat a lot. Typical quasars consume 1 to 100 Earth masses of gas per minute. 10 billion years ago, the universe was about a third of its current...
You'd think it'd be a lot more, wouldn't you? Right? Like, that's not that much when you really think about how big these things are.
Size. So the intergalactic medium was much less spread out, meaning the filaments of gas around quasars could feed them a banquet, making them vomit insane amounts of light and radiation.
This is also why I said before the galaxies, you know, would almost as much mass, were much smaller, much more dense. The universe at this early time, the universe was much smaller and much more dense. And so everything was closer together. And you had quasars. And that's one of the hypotheses for why the quasars were more prevalent in the early universe. Everything's just more dense. So you had matter coalescing and gravitationally collapsing more often. And then, you know, if you get a quasar in one little spot, it just sort of launches out this giant death beam and just annihilates everything in its path.
The brightest quasars power jets, tangling the magnetic field of the matter around them into a narrow cone.
So around this thing, right, you've got all this matter. You know, a lot of it, you know, is electrically charged. And so, you know, if you move electric charge around, you generate a magnetic field. And you do that with a lot of matter, with a lot of energy, and you get a lot of strong magnetic fields. And they all kind of, you know, as moving around this thing, and they all kind of get twisted, and they all interact with each other. And so they whip around the black hole, and they twist and they break. And that basically results in the mechanisms behind that in this beam that shoots out perpendicular, just like they're showing here. Now, this is, it's so strange. You know, you've got this flat disk, and you've got these like death beams coming out on both sides. But there's also a lot more to this, which I don't think they're going to talk about here, right? Quasars might have multiple modes, like a radio mode and a quasar mode. And so this is what you'd call the quasar mode, when these beams are active. But there's also a radio mode, where it also is shooting out these jets, but a much more sort of wider sort of... it's not really a beam at that point, right? It's shooting out just like radio waves.
Like a particle accelerator, they launch enormous beams of matter out, plowing through the circumgalactic medium, forming plumes of matter that grow
like a giant fart, doesn't it?
To hundreds of thousands of light years in size. It's almost unfathomable in scale. A tiny spot in a galaxy carving out patches of the universe, hundreds of thousands.
They also can make different shapes as well, which is really cool. There's like an X one, which I don't think we still understand.
Of light years long. But quasars can't eat for long, maybe a few million years, because their feast...
They're also what we call active galactic nuclei, right? Because you've got the galactic nuclei, this thing, and it's active. We say it turns on, the galaxy turns on. We think all galaxies are capable of doing this if you feed enough matter into the big boy at the center, the supermassive black hole.
...to ultimately kills their galaxy.
They don't always kill the galaxy.
Quasars kill galaxies. Okay, maybe killing is a bit of an exaggeration. A galaxy is still there after its quasar turns off, but it will never be the same again. Quasars, being among the hottest and brightest things in the universe, break their galaxies by heating them up too much and stopping star formation. Stars are gas that collapsed in on itself and then got really hot. But in a cloud of gas that's already hot, atoms are moving quickly. When they collide, they hit hard, exerting pressure that resists gravity's squeeze. So hot gas cannot form stars. Instead, the best gas for forming stars is already cold and won't put up a fight when it's time to collapse into a star. On top of that, quasars push gas out of their galaxies. Not only does this starve the quasar, but its galaxy loses the raw materials for new stars. As sad as this sounds, it might be a good thing for life. The alternative...
Yes, because, you know, there are hypotheses abound about how this can, you know, destroy life in the galaxy as well, as you've probably already imagined, right? And not only that, the local galaxies. Those galaxies, again, were closer together in the early days. Satellite galaxies, we'd call them.
...can be far more dangerous. Too many stars. New stars forming is usually followed by massive stars exploding in supernovae, so planets would be burned sterile. But of course, it's more complicated. Like the intricacies of our own planet's biosphere, every piece of the galaxy is dependent on and influencing every other part of the galactic environment.
Yes.
While hot things like quasars and supernovae tend to push gas out of the galaxy, shockwaves and quasar jets can also compress gas, making new stars at least for a short time. Did the Milky Way have a quasar in the past?
Yes, it did. At least we think. And it could come back again, which is kind of cool. And, you know, the problem is we're in the galaxy itself, so it's very hard to see what's going on.
It's unclear if every galaxy went through a quasar phase, but understanding...
You should probably be saying that about a lot of things in this video. Because the science is not settled. A lot of this stuff is unclear. There's scientific consensus in, like, opinions. But, you know, science isn't about opinions, isn't it?
Distant quasars may provide clues to the history of the Milky Way. Galaxies don't do a good job of preserving their history. Like sand on a beach, the endless churning mixes away the clues to their past. It's possible the Milky Way was once a...
A bit like Earth's surface, hey. You know, the surface is constantly being reshaped with, you know, volcanic activity and magma. And the rock is constantly being folded and moved and morphed. It's beautiful.
Quasar, which may have allowed our supermassive black hole Sagittarius A star to have grown to 4 million times the mass of the sun. And as...
Okay, I'm gonna read it to you, okay? You have to read quickly because with times... Maybe we don't need to do times two just because... we'll do 1.5 because without sound, it's not as fun. And as dormant as it is now, billions of years in the Milky Way will merge with Andromeda. We've never... Okay, it's not that quick. Quasars in galaxies smash together where fresh gas is provided for the central black holes. But it won't last for long. When galaxies merge, so do their supermassive black holes. Sinking into the center of the new galaxy, kicking up dust, we don't know whether this will happen yet, but it will truly be an incredible sight. Maybe some beings in the far future are going to see, witness it and be in awe of what they see. That was pretty good. I think, you know, it was 11 minutes. This stream has been like an hour, so we clearly talked about a lot. So, how about we go...